Cool. So when and you obviously know what you're doing. So when you're researching songs or film and TV, what is your favorite or your best technique for studying these songs? You know, if you were to tell somebody new, this is the way I want you to study these songs, you know, what would you tell them?
Okay, let me take you right through. I developed this over a long period of time. Initially, and Taxi was a true, and I was a screener there, because how do you give a critique on something as unusual as indie singer-songwriter? How do you tell someone you're not vague enough? I mean, you know, it's when you get into film and TV and you get into some of this stuff, it's out there. So if I'm listening to Daughter, let's say, there's a wonderful song called Medicine. I don't know how many of you have heard that song by Daughter. Oh, it's gorgeous. And it was used the whole thing. I mean, I think they probably edited it to make it even longer. And they used it in a, I think it was Person of Interest episode. So if I were watching that and I'm going, how is that creating that tremendous atmospheric vibe? And at the same time, it's a song. I mean, it's not an instrumental. And how much is she singing? How are they creating the atmospheric track? So I came up with, eventually, as I went through these things, I came up with seven ingredients in the emotional stew. Because what you're looking for is what's the emotion or mood or atmosphere that this song is creating. If it's a song that's being used as source music, it just needs to be a realistic for the scene. So if it's a nightclub, it needs to be a realistic sounding nightclub song. You know, if it's in a yoga class, it needs to be realistically something they would play in a yoga class. That's different from what I call song score, which is underscore for a scene, and that song is there to enhance the emotion, atmosphere, energy, or mood of the scene. And so the question you want to ask yourself is, how did it do that? So I've discovered there's like seven things that go together to make up an emotional or atmospheric recipe for that song. And the seven things are, wait a minute, I have them written down here because I
I
can
take my
remember.
note. I gotta take notes.
Take notes, okay. Here we go. Because I have to take notes or I can't remember them. The first one is rhythm. It's much more important than you may think it is. It took me a long time to arrive at that. It's that rhythm sets up so much of the energy level and the groove and the feel, your body feel underneath that song. Boy, is that important. Even songs that don't have a percussion track are creating a rhythm on guitar or on piano or something. Rhythm, and that includes tempo, you know, the underlying steady beat, and the groove, the way that the beats are subdivided so they make your body feel like moving. Chords, then melody, lyrics. So that's all the song stuff. That's all the stuff you write. And then, of course, we do our own arranging a lot of times. So instrumental arranging, vocal performance, and mix. Those are the seven things. And when one of those changes, it changes the flavor of the dish that you're making. So in other words, if you were making soup and you put in less salt, it would taste different than soup with more salt in it. And literally, you can, by messing with these a bit, and it's really fun to play with it. Once you start have a song put together, start messing with each one of those and go, whoa, that changed everything. You know? So if you change the groove underneath a song, you can take a song and do a cover version of it. Let's say you took a hit song, because this is really a popular thing to do for TV. And on YouTube, it's very popular to do cover songs. Covering a song with one groove that made it a hit and using a completely different rhythm, tempo, and groove can completely change the song. Take a listen to, if you ever want to have some fun, you remember that wonderful classic rock song called Sea of Love? Maybe I wanna know. Da, 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 da.
I think so.
I wanna take you. It's yeah, Sea of Love. Anyway, and Cat Power does a cover of it that's hysterical. She's got an auto harp, and that's it. It's an out of tune auto harp, and her, and it got used in a Lincoln commercial. So
I love her. Yeah, I'll have to look
she's
that up.
nuts.
That's
She's
cool.
nuts. And she's got a whole record album called Covers. I don't know how I've got off on that, but just to see,
Yeah,
it's
cool.
play with. It's one of those things of I don't feel like sitting down to write a song. It's one of those things you can do to trick yourself into sitting down and working on something. And that is, I'm going to take a hit song and I'm going to totally rip the groove off of it and sing a version with just maracas. And once you start doing that, then you're launched. Then you're off into a writing session and you're going, okay, now I'm going to drop that song out and I'm going to write my own song to those chords. And you have a new song with an interesting beat to it that has nothing to do with the original cover song you started working with. So that's just one of those tricks that you can do to get your fool yourself into it. So that's I can
a quick question in the chat. Somebody just says, how often do you use progressions other than 1, 4, 5, 6? I would say...
Other than 1, 4, 5, 6?
Yeah.
How often do you use chords other than 1, 4, 5, 6?
Progressions, I guess.
Progressions? Well, we don't use 1, 4, 5, 6 too much as a progression.
Yeah.
But I could sit here and read you chord progressions. I mean, I just finished putting them in my book. I went through and I did 4 chord progressions.
Oh, cool. I can't wait to see the book.
Well, there's only so many because you only got 4 chords. And if all you're doing is changing the key, it's the same progression.
Right.
So yes, you can go watch the video Axis of Awesome. You all know it. Yeah, 4 chords. Go watch that one. That's the famous one that has the, you know, 1, 4, 5, 6, whatever it is, the famous chord progression that's in so many hits. But the thing is, it was in that many hits, and because every one, the melody, the lyrics, the underlying groove, all those things are different in every one of those mm-hmm. songs. And when you start missing, and then on top of that, within that chord progression, you can add those dissonant notes and create a sixth or a major seventh or any of those things, and the permutations become huge.
Yeah.
And that's why you can have a song like Stronger, What Doesn't Kill You by Kelly Clarkson, which is a 4 chord progression. It's one of the common ones. Mm-hmm. I don't often my head have it. I should, but I don't. But you can listen to that and it doesn't sound like another song that uses the same identical chord progression, because so many things about it have changed. Enough of those 7 ingredients have changed. Remember, the chord progression is only one of the ingredients,
right?
And that itself can be changed by adding extra notes to it and subtracting notes, and you know, but the other 6 ingredients are completely mutable. So you can take any progression, and that's a really good challenge, is to take a couple of these progressions and start messing with the other 6 ingredients and start messing with the, and see what happens to the emotional feel and energetic feel. One of the other thing to notice, by the way, is that the Tim Myers song I just played for you is much slower.
Yeah.
The underlying beat is much slower than Empire of the Sun, which actually feels like it has less energy because the energy is kind of smooth and flowing. And the Tim Myers song is actually slower in terms of the underlying beat. 1, 2, 3, 4. But he's breaking it up, the subdivisions, into 1E and a 2E and a 3E and a 4. So he gives you all these subdivisions with this kind of 2 chord progression. It doesn't, there's so much energy going on that you don't even notice. I didn't notice it was a 2 chord progression at all.
Well, and that's the thing. It's like a lot of people think, you know, you've got to build the song along with like a new chord or, you know, a different, or change the chord pattern when you get to the chorus. And that's not always the case. There's so many songs that
have
4 chords all the way through.
It's not. And you can vary the chord progression. You can, another trick is to start your melody on a different chord in the chord progression. And that makes it sound like a different chord progression. Mm-hmm. And that's a trick that you hear in a lot of hits. So writing top line, when somebody gives you, and every music publisher in town wants you to be able to write top line, right? Write melody and lyrics on top of an existing track. And these existing tracks are mostly, if you get a track from Ryan Tedder, it's going to be 4 chords. Yeah. So when you look at Counting Stars, which is him, mm-hmm. it's a 4 chord song. Here's another example. Halo is one of the best examples of how to get a melody on top of a 4 chord progression and make it gorgeous. So I love Halo. I think it's a great song. And it's been covered to death. I mean, it really is the song that can take covers. It's that good. It's a 4 chord song. The original track was written by Ryan Tedder. And the publisher, and notice where the melody line, that every melody line starts on beat 3. Every single one, and it runs through the chord change and it ends in the middle of the next chord. And that's the trick to writing a Halo. Now you go look at Kelly Clarkson's Already Gone. It's what happened was the publisher sent out the same Ryan Tedder track to 2 different artists, Kelly Clarkson and Beyonce, and they both wrote songs to it. And then they found out the publisher had done that. And so Ryan Tedder had to go in and completely change the track for the Kelly Clarkson. song, which he did. But when you listen to the two of them, they basically were the same track. They were both writing the same track. And they came up with two very different hits. To me, Halo is a classic song that will last long beyond Already Gone.
Yeah.
But it's a classic song, a masterclass in studying how to write a four chord, a melody to a four chord. One of those skills you really need to have if you're going to be competitive as a songwriter.
Yeah, definitely. And, you know, there's a lot of technical stuff to this too. And, you know, as songwriters, a lot of us, we like to feel our way through it, right?
Sure.
It is eye-opening, and you know it's in the books too, just to see how, you know, technically you can break things down, and then being able to incorporate that into your overall creativity without getting too technical. And sometimes
the trick to doing that is to embed these techniques. So if I say the trick to writing to a four chord progression is to start your melody on a variety of beats, you have to tell yourself, oh, I'm starting because I changed the chord on beat one as I play the guitar. I have a tendency to start the melody on beat one and start a new phrase on beat one. That's very typical. And that's a habit. It's just a habit. It's not what you really feel. It's not really you. It's nothing but a habit. And it's an easy way to write. So to break that habit, you start making yourself start singing on beat three. Or beat two, or beat four. And then you try a couple of lines that way. Learn, the best way to embed these new techniques is to go learn a few songs. Go learn to sing and play Halo if you can.
Yeah.
Go learn to sing and play it. And that'll start to embed the feeling in your body. Songwriting is body writing. It's a lot in the physical. It's a lot physical. It's not mental, it's physical. And that's that thing that you want. You want to be sitting there feeling it and letting your body translate that into rhythm, in beats and chords and melody, and that's so physical. So learn, embed some of those songs that have the techniques that you want to learn. Mm-hmm. And then the next time you go to write a song, you're going to start seeing some choices there that you didn't have before. And that's what you want. Your authentic voice starts to come through when you give yourself a range of choices and you choose the one that expresses what you feel. That's when your authentic voice starts coming out, not when you're doing things out of habit.
Right. Yep. That is true.
So a lot of times what I'll do is just go to TuneFind and I will look up a show like Guilt is a great example because I think I printed something out. Yes, I did. Guilt is a summer series. G-U-I-L-T is the name of the show. And I don't know if it's on Netflix because this is the first season. It just started in June. It's a summer replacement. We have shows now. We have seasons. We have three seasons instead of just one with a big fall season. Right. Then we have a summer season that's a very legitimate season now. And we have a winter season that starts in January. And so we have shows year round. I mean, there's no more of this reruns in the summertime and everybody goes home for 6 months. We don't do that. So here's Guilt. It started on June 10th, the pilot. It has 10 songs in it. They just loaded the pilot with songs. But one of the things you can see right away, if you go to TuneFind, T-U-N-E-F-I-N-D, yeah, TuneFind.com, and you look up Guilt, and you see what the songs are, what songs are being used, and how they're being used. That'll tell you a lot about whether or not that's a show you want to check out. So in this show, it's obvious that some character owns a nightclub or they hang out in a nightclub quite a bit because there's quite a lot of EDM songs and the scene description is in the nightclub. So if you do EDM, you're going to want to look at this show and take and see if there's anything there that you should be writing or you should be looking at. But there's two or three really interesting song uses and it makes me want to watch this show. Here's the scene description. The song is Fear is Like Fire. By Fink is the artist. Reeling from the death of her friend, Grace and Luke have sex in his loft. A little bit of a non sequitur there, yeah. But you get the idea. It's probably that song is probably up full during that scene.
Yeah.
And that's what you want to see. You want to look at those scenes because those are the ones you're going to aim at if you're writing for film and television song score. I'm not familiar with that song or that show. So I would probably go take a look. And just to see what's going on. They are also using People by Kai Kai and Grace going for a run, runs into a mob of paparazzi. There's probably a little of that song that's up full while she runs. And then there's a closing song called Bad Dream, by Ruel, R-U-E-L-L-E. And that's got to be a song I would want to be, to, you know, listen to.
Because it was a closing song, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Tune Finder is really helpful because you're right. We don't have time to watch all these shows. There's only certain things I watch. But yeah, you start to get used to it. Like at first when I started listening to music, it kind of ruined the TV show because I'm like, now I'm focusing on the music all the time. But now at least I can blend the two together finally, enjoy the show. Yeah. I'll be like, oh, that's a cool song. We look that up later.
I just hit up Tune Find. That determines my viewing.
I teach them about your, you have a game in your film and TV thing called like the association game. Yeah. And I found that really useful for a lot of things that, you know, I've written that I was trying to be more creative about. And sometimes it would take me down a rabbit hole, but in a good way. Because to start with, you totally like end up with something different. But I guess somebody just wanted to know, I guess, more about it or how you came about, you know, doing that. Any insight?
Well, this is the, all writers do this. This isn't limited to songwriters. All writers do this. Poets do this. It's where you once you know what your theme is, or you have your title, or generally will tell you what your theme, you know what you're writing about. Once you have a title that stimulates you, you've got to think about what am I writing about to this title? What does this title mean? And once you begin to get an idea of what the general feeling emotion is, you have to turn that emotion into images, actions, examples. You have to turn that emotion into words because you can't just say, I miss you. I really, really miss you. I really, really miss you. It just, you can say that all night long and nobody feels that any more than the first time you said it. And that's the trick of writing. Every writer knows it. Novelists, poets, songwriters, everybody. We all know that you can't just say, I love you. And so what do? And that's where you start associating, as we all do. So when I miss you doesn't work, you end up saying, I miss you like the deserts miss the rain.
Right.
That wonderful line from Everything But the Girl song, Missing. If you haven't heard that song, God said, go listen to it. And that is the refrain. There's hardly a chorus. It's just a two-line refrain. And I miss you like the deserts miss the rain. That's how I miss you. I miss you like thirst. I miss you like the loneliness of desert. Because the minute you think of desert, you get an image in your head and a feeling about deserts, which isn't good generally. Some people grew up in the desert, they love the desert.
Right.
But it's still a lonely place, an empty place, and a dangerous place. And all those things come up for listeners instantly. They can't stop it. We don't have a shut down door in our brains that says, don't think about that. We just can't get there fast enough. And so when you say desert, everybody gets an image.
Right.
When I say rain, you get a different image. Everybody gets a slightly different image, but we get a lot of the same associations of green, fertility, warmth, humid, tropical. Rain has lots of associations. And so when I say like the deserts miss the rain, all of that's happening. And it's happening so fast that we as listeners don't even think about it. But we as writers have to think about it. If I put in a word that does not have particular, and I miss you like Mars, that doesn't go anywhere because we don't miss Mars. We have no associations with the planet Mars. And if we did, they wouldn't be missing it. So that's something that you're not going to say because none of us is an alien. None of us misses things that really other people don't miss. I mean, we have shared associations that are pretty much universal, especially when you get into colors, seasons, any kind of nature, noises, skin touches, any kind of sensual, anything having to do with the senses, which of course images are your eyes. I mean, that's one of the senses. Anything having to do with the senses, smell, touch, taste, sight, hearing, all of those. You know, your angry words cut like a knife. And one of my favorite lines was Jagged Little Pill. Mm. Jagged Little Pill is one of those images that also hurts. Mm-hmm. It physically hurts, that image. And it, when you come up with images like that, that say, this is how your anger makes me feel, this is what your words are doing, then your listener is unequivocally involved in your song. They cannot not be involved because we don't have a way to shut that down. And that's why writers use it. A novelist, they can shut the book. They don't have to read that paragraph. But a song unreels in real time, and it goes right by your ears. And just as that image goes by, the listener is filling their head with it, and it moves on. Give them a chance to do that. That's the other thing. Watch when you use lots of images and associations. Reinforce them. Support them. Give them another line. Feel it. Because listeners like to feel.
Yeah.
They like that. That's why we listen to songs, is we like to feel. So if you give me sunrises and ice cream and pink and golden and cold with an edge of sugar on it, I'm involved instantly. You know, go write that. And that's the trick of writing associative language. It took me a long time to learn that when I was screening a taxi, and I would get these very, very singer-songwriter songs, these alt singer-songwriter songs, and they would be very associative and nonlinear. I had to figure out how to give feedback on that, because nonlinear is perfectly acceptable.
Right.
But when you're doing it, know that you have to keep your listener with you still by staying within a family of images and a family of associations. And that's also, that's in the first book, that's in the hit songwriting book. A family, use a family of associations. Don't stray too far out. Don't suddenly jump from those, you know, pink ice cream sugars to some dungeon somewhere with a dragon, because listeners can't follow you. They're in one place they want to be. And if you're going to pull them someplace else, you have to gradually pull them to that place.